Hi, hello, welcome you all to this new session. Today in this video we'll be learning about 12 principles of animation. So let us start. So the first principle of animation is squash and stretch. Now what it is? The purpose of squash and stretch is to give a sense of weight and flexibility to the drawn objects. That means if the object is a bouncing ball, then depending upon the weight of the object, it should bounce, it should appear, the weight and the size and the bounciness of the ball should appear when you animate the same. Similarly, if you are bouncing something stretchable object, that stretchness should also be felt while bouncing. So in this way, depending upon the weight and flexibility of the drawn object, it should be clearly conveyed through the pictures you are drawing for the animation. So this is what is meant by squash and stretch. Next principle is anticipation. Anticipation is used to prepare the audience for an action. What we are doing? We are actually preparing the audience for an action. For what? So that they can make the action more realistic. How? See, we all know that when a dancer jumps off from the floor, he tries to bend his knees. So whenever the person tries to bend his knees, the user can anticipate that yes, he's going to do something. Maybe he's going to jump or he's going to do something. So in this way, if we are able to create a sense of anticipation through the images we are creating, and then we can say that we have successfully inputted anticipation. Okay, so through the actions we can define what the person is going to do next. Clear? Next comes staging. Now what is staging? Staging is actually done for the purpose to direct the audience attention. We are grabbing the audience attention. We are trying to convey the matter clearly within their minds. So if we are doing something or through the images or scenes, if we are able to convey the matter clearly without any mistakes, so this way of presenting the matter completely unmistakably before the audience is known as staging. Next comes straight ahead action and pose to pose. These are two different approaches actually. Now the first one is straight ahead action. In straight ahead action, animations is performed in such a way that the frame by frame scenes are created and they are played from the beginning to the end. Each scene is played from the beginning to the end. So every individual scene has to be created. Whereas for pose to pose, we do actually create only the keyframes. We actually create only the keyframes. And through the method of in-betweening, all the necessary frames that have to be put in between two main keyframes are created randomly. Okay, so we actually create just the keyframes and the necessary in-between frames are created later. Whereas in straight-ahead action, all the frames have to be created in advance and they are played from beginning to end. Okay, now comes follow-through and overlapping action. Now, what is this follow-through and overlapping action? See, the image clearly shows the movement of a horse. A man is riding over it, is it? Now we know that when a horse is moving, along with its movement, there are certain other parts of the object that move along with the main body part. That means they follow the actual action. I can clearly explain it to you. See, through this technique, we can render the movement more realistically by applying the laws of physics over here. How? See, the loosely tied parts of a body should continue move even after the character has stopped. That means though the horse is moving, depending on the movement of the horse, the tail part, which is much lighter than its body, the tail part should show the movement in continuity so that the picture or the scene appears to be more realistic. So the loosely tied portions of the body should show the movement in continuous fashion. Okay, next comes slow in and slow out. Well, the movement of objects in the real world is represented through this slow in and slow out movements. That means we all know that between two major poses, but he wishes to stand up. So these are two different poses. Now to make the sitting person stand, we need to input number of frames in between so that we can have a continuous movement which clearly explains how the person who was sitting earlier is now going to stand. Okay, so this change from one pose to another can be showed down in a slow motion. So this is how you can represent. Okay, so this mode of variation from one pose to another is explained with the help of slow in and slow out poses. Now something else can be also said. See, if I'm having a vehicle and it is to be animated, we all know that vehicles need time to accelerate and also need time to slow down. These are not sudden actions. So such actions which cannot be performed in a sudden way and which require certain time period for its execution to be completed, such actions can be represented using slow in and slow out mode. Next is an arc movement. What is this arc movement? See, most natural actions tend to follow an arced trajectory. That means if an object which is having maximum speed, I'm talking about an object which is moving with its maximum speed, or I can say it is having greatest momentum in it, with the increased momentum, the object tends to be flattened. He is trying to throw an object from one position to another position. If the object is thrown with high or increased momentum, the path through which the object is going to travel will tend to be flattened. Whereas if it is having decreased momentum, the flatness of the path used, and this motion of semi-circle format motion, the motion of an object, is tend to be an arc principle. This is how we can define an arc principle. Object is moving in a trajectory path. Next comes secondary action. Secondary action means we are adding supporting actions, or we are adding extra actions to support the main action. That means if I wish to show a person who is walking with a high speed, depending upon the speed with which he is walking, he may wave his hands too. Or the speedness may reflect on his face. Sometimes the words are less but actions are more. We can understand more what he is going to say even without a single word is coming out from his mouth. We can read his face through his expressions. So to show off to present a particular action, if we are using some supporting actions, such a supporting action is known as a secondary action. Next comes timing. What is this timing? What does timing mean? Timing means the number of frames that are actually needed to present a scene. We are having just one scene, but that single scene needs to be shot with thousands of frames. What is the speed with which these frames have to be moved? So the speed with which certain frames are moved so that a scene seems to be animated. That speed corresponds to the timing of the frame. Timing is very important. Because if the timing between the movement of these frames are that less, then it won't appear to be moving to a human eye. Next is exaggeration. What is exaggeration? Exaggeration is actually an effect especially useful for animation. Why? Because animated motions, if they thoroughly imitate or perfectly imitate the reality, they will look static and dull. If they show or perfectly imitate the reality, they will definitely show or look static and dull. So to avoid this form of staticness or dullness, what we can do through the comic scenes, we can exaggerate, we can overemphasize the scene. This form of overemphasizing or exaggerating a scene is called exaggeration. To add something extra, that is what is meant by exaggeration. Okay, next is solid drawing. This is the next principle. What is meant by solid drawing? Solid drawing means taking into account that an animator needs to be a skilled artist who can understand the basics of a 3D shape, its anatomy, its weight, balance, light, shadow, everything. Only if he is aware of every nook and corner of this 3D world, he can create amazingly better animation series. Okay. Next principle is, and obviously the last principle, is what is known as appeal. What is appeal? Appeal in a cartoon character corresponds to what is called how a particular character appeals to an audience. That means with its look, its behavior, its performance, it should be able to captivate the attention of the user, irrespective of whether that character is a villain or a comic character, whatever it may be. Even if it's a monster, the look doesn't matter. But what matters is the way it is presented before the audience. The charisma should appear. With its performance, it should be able to captivate the attention of each and every audience. Only then we can say it is appealing. Okay, so these are the different principles of animation. Hope the concept explained over there are clearly understandable to all of you. Hope you are able to follow the concepts. Keep on watching the videos and support me. Subscribe the channel if you are not yet subscribed. And don't forget to hit the bell icon and click on the all options so that you may get all the notifications whenever I put on a new video. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.